my God will reign forever. All the world will know his name. Everyone together, sing the song of the redeemed. I know that my Redeemer lives, and now I stand on what he did. My Savior lives. Every day a brand new chance to say, Jesus, you are the only way. My Savior lives. I know that my Redeemer lives, and now I stand on what he did. My Savior lives. Every day a brand new chance to say, Jesus, you are the only way. My Savior lives. King has come from heaven. Darkness trembles at his name. Victory forever is the song of the redeemed. I know that my Redeemer lives, and now I stand on what he did. My Savior lives. Every day a brand new chance to say, Jesus, you are the only way. My Savior lives. I know that my Redeemer lives, and now I stand on what he did. My Savior lives. Every day a brand new chance to say, Jesus, you are the only way. My Savior lives. My Savior lives. I know that my Redeemer lives, and now I stand on what he did. My Savior lives. Every day a brand new chance to say, Jesus, you are the only way. My Savior lives. Every day a brand new chance to say, Jesus, you are the only way. My Savior lives. We'll sing, 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 and make music with the heavens. We will sing, 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 grateful that you hear us when we shout your praise. Lift high the name of Jesus. We will sing. We will sing, 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 and make music with the heavens. We will sing, 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 and we shout your praise, lift high the name of Jesus. What's not to love about you? Heaven and earth adore you. Kings and kingdoms bow down. Son of God, you are the one. You are the one we're living for. You are the love that frees us. You are the light that leads us. Like a fire burning, Son of God, you are the one. You are the one we're living for. music with the heavens. We will sing, sing, sing. Grateful that you hear us when we shout your praise. Lift high the name of Jesus. And we will sing, sing, sing. And make music with the heavens. We will sing, sing, sing. Grateful that you hear us when we shout your praise. Lift high the name of Jesus.
One more time.
We will sing, sing, sing. And make music with the heavens. We will sing, sing, sing. Grateful that you hear us when we shout your praise. Lift high the name of Jesus.
Come on, you can clap. Yeah. It was a happy day when Jesus took my sins away.
This day with mystery, death is beaten, you have rescued me. Sing it out, Jesus is alive. Cross the empty grave. Life eternal, you have won the day. Shout it out, Jesus is alive. He's alive. And oh, happy day, happy day. He washed my sin away. Oh, happy day, happy day. I'll never be the same. Oh, happy day, happy day. He washed my sin away. Oh, happy day. Jesus, you are mine. Give us joy, perfect peace. Perfect faith, finally we'll see. Celebrate, Jesus is alive. He's alive. Oh, happy day, happy day. Wash my sin away. Oh, happy day, happy day. Never be the same. Oh, happy day, happy day. Wash my sin away. Oh, happy day, happy day. Never be the same. Glorious way that you have saved me. Oh, what a glorious day, what a glorious way that you have saved me. Oh, what a glorious day, what a glorious way that you have saved me. What a glorious name, what a glorious name. He's alive. Oh, happy day, happy day. You wash my sin away. Oh, happy day, happy day. I'll never be the same. Oh, happy day, happy day. Wash my sin away. Oh, happy day, happy day. Never be the same.
This thing is called Oh the Blood. Thing about the blood of Jesus. Is that it'll wash your sins away and make you white as snow. Thing about the blood of Jesus is the blood of Jesus was shed for you. We should have had to shed our own blood for our own sins. But Jesus said, I'll take that sin upon myself and I'll die in your place. And you know what? You didn't have to ask him to. You didn't have to beg him to. He did it willingly. He went to the cross willingly. He took the stripes that we should have taken willingly. Because he loves us.
Oh, the blood, the crimson love, price of life's demand. The shameful sin placed on him, the hope every man. Oh, the blood of Jesus washes me. Oh, the blood that Jesus shed for me. What a sacrifice to save my life. Yes, the blood, it is my victory. Savior, Son, the Holy One, slain so I can live. See the Lamb, the great I who takes away my sin. Oh, the blood of Jesus washes me. Oh, the blood of Jesus shed for me. Oh, what a sacrifice that saved my life. Yes, the blood, it is my victory. Oh, the blood of Jesus.
Dear Heavenly Father, we thank you for the blood. Oh, hallelujah. Thank you for your blood, Lord.
Talking about the blood washing you white as snow. Let me tell you, I don't know, I don't care who you are tonight. You can still come to the foot of the cross. You can still find Jesus Christ. You know, he's not dead. He's risen, amen.
Foot of the cross. I'll
give myself to you tonight. At the foot of the cross. Amen.
Hallelujah.
Amen. Let's give the Lord a hand clap of praise. You may be seated.
Hallelujah.
Invite our pastor now to come. Come greet you, and then we'll take up our offering. If our ushers could get ready to take up the offering, please.
Walked him aside ahead with her purse. It hurt him bad. They found out later she had a brick in that purse. So, and I didn't believe it was a spectator. I mean, I didn't believe it was a participation sport unless you were one of the wrestlers. But we're so glad to have you here tonight to hear from a man whose career I followed as a fan for a number of years. And as he begins his journey, we want to thank you for coming. We did not sell tickets to this event, but if you would like to contribute to help us with the expense, we would certainly appreciate it. God bless you. Oh, will the ushers please come up? This opportunity to serve you. We ask you bless those who give, bless those who came with magic and with the touch of your word. In Jesus' name, amen. Amen. This is Father's Day weekend, and tomorrow, at 11 o'clock at Glad Tidings Assembly of God Church, right behind Whataburger, Ted's going to be speaking again to our morning worship service, and we'd love to have you come out. Tuesday, our kids, 6 to 12, are going to be going to the movies. We have what we call a summer movie club, and if you will call the church tomorrow or Monday, we'll give you some details about that. And we look forward to seeing you there. We'd love to have you come out and worship with us. Amen.
Amen.
WWE champ and God's champion, Ted DiBiase.
Folks, it's a pleasure to be with you here this evening. I just want to say this up front, especially Pastor George. You know, I think all of us would love to see this building full, but God doesn't waste anything. There's a purpose in everything. And I shared a story with Pastor about it many, many years ago when I first started evangelizing. I went to a town in Canada. This is like, I'm like only 2 years out of the ring physically, still on television every week. And, you know, it's like 20 people showed up. And I was a little bit dejected. And I shared. One young man walked down the aisle that day, made a profession of Christ. And after I greeted everybody, he waited. He came up to me and I told him I was happy for the decision he made. He said, you know, when I left my house tonight, I was looking for a place to commit suicide. And he said, I drove by this church and saw your name on the billboard. It always been a wrestling fan. And I came in, and he says, quite frankly, when you started to preach, I started to get up and leave. He said, but for some reason, I couldn't get out of my chair. And he said, you saved my life tonight. I said, no, sir. God saved your life.
Amen.
And then so there's always a purpose. And I just want all of you to know, it took a while. I'm going to share that story with you for God to humble me. But God did a good job of humbling me. So I'm not about numbers. I have never been about numbers. A lot of times people will approach me, churches will approach me about coming to speak. And they'll say, well, how many people do we have to have before you'll come? I said, well, at least one. I'm not into the numbers game. I'm in the serving Jesus Christ. So, only God knows for sure. And maybe there's one person here tonight that doesn't know Jesus, has never made a profession of faith. Maybe this whole night's just for you. You know, I had an encounter with an atheist. It's funny, I had gone to the Gulf Coast of Mississippi to speak, and it wasn't even it wasn't a Christian function, it was a secular function, it was a motivational speech. And they had me staying at a hotel adjacent to one of the casinos down there. And so as I walked through the lobby, I stopped to get a cup of coffee, and the guy says, I'm making a fresh pot. So I'm waiting for a fresh pot of coffee, and these two guys are having a conversation, kind of a debate, and then one guy turns around and he recognized me. I think it's the first time I was ever recognized for being a minister and not a wrestler. And he said, Ted, I've seen you on Christian television. He said, can you help me out here? And I'd been listening to a little bit of that conversation. So I said to this atheist, I said, you know what, Allison, you're entitled to believe anything you want to believe. And I said, it's no sweat off my back. And I said, I'm not here to get a big argument and fight. I said, but let me just ask you a couple of questions. Is that okay? He said, sure. I said, first of all, I said, have you ever read the Bible? And he said, no. I said, okay. I said, in reality, there are actually hundreds of religions, but there's four or five, you know, world religions that everybody knows about. You know, there's the Muslim faith, the Hindus, the Buddhists, the Christians, the Jews, and actually Judaism and Christianity go hand in hand. I said, could you tell me how they differ? Can you tell me what one believes as to what another one believes? And again, his answer was, no, not really. And I said, here's what you just told me by answering just those two questions. You just told me that you're telling me that you don't believe in a God that you've never spent 15 minutes looking for. I said, let's just say for the sake of argument, let's say you're right and I'm wrong. There's no God. You know, evolution's true. This all happened by chance. I said, if that's the truth, then I guess it really won't matter. We'll die one day, we'll just cease to exist. I said, but for the same sake of argument, Let's say I'm right, you're wrong. I said, you see, if I'm right, you're wrong for eternity. That's a long time to be wrong. And I said, I'm sorry. I said, but if there's a fraction of a chance that I'm right, you don't owe it to me. You don't owe it to this guy you're having this debate with. You owe it to yourself to find out. Amen. Because what hangs in the balance is eternity. And I said, now I'm going to say something that probably is going to mean to me. I said, now I'm going to tell you why you haven't looked for God. And he said, yeah, what's that? You don't want to know. You see, as long as you can say there's no God, then you're in control. There's no one you have to answer to. But whether you believe in him or not, he is real. As a matter of fact, if you take the journey, you'll find out that there's more evidence to the deity of Jesus Christ than there is anything else in secular history. Oh, and about evolution? I said, believing in evolution is like believing that you can take all the parts of a jumbo jet airliner, disassemble, throw them in an airplane hangar, leave, and come back in a billion years, and somehow that sucker put itself together and flies perfectly. That's what evolution wants you to believe. That all this happened by accident. The Big Bang Theory. Oh, I believe there was a Big Bang. It was when God said, let there be light. And oh yes, God made all of this in 7 literal days. Evening and morning, the first day. What's that mean? Well, that means one day. You don't compromise that either. Because if there's a God out there, and there is, that's big enough to make all of this, he can make it in 7 days. Mm-hmm. It's just like those people that say they, you know, they discovered DNA and, well, you know what, man came from dirt, right? God made us out of the dirt. And even if a man got to a place where he said, well, I'm going to make my own man. I said, really? I would say, okay, make your own dirt. What I'm trying to get you to do, if you're here tonight, and you're a doubter. Because I'm here to get you to think. Now, there are so many other things I can share with you in terms of what we call apologetics. Reasons I believe. But the greatest reason that I believe is what God's done in my own life. Not only what God has done in my own life, but as a man of God, as a minister of the gospel, what I've seen God do in the lives of countless people in the last 20 years. Actually, the last 14 years of my life as a full-time minister. One of the questions I'm often asked is, of all the things I could have chosen to do in life, why did I choose to be a professional wrestler? Let's face it, folks, that's not a normal job. What do you do if you're up for a living, Dad? I don't run around in spandex and hit people in with chairs. That's not normal. But the answer to the question in a word is Dad. I was fortunate. I was raised by a very loving stepfather. Married my mother when I was 5. Mike DiBiase, son of Italian immigrants, came into my life when I was 5. A professional wrestler. Also a national amateur wrestling champion out of the University of Nebraska. Storied career. I knew none of that at 5. All I knew is that this man came into my life, showed me his love, gave me his love, and his name, and I wanted to be just like him. So I wanted to be a wrestler, I wanted to play football, I wanted to do all those things my dad did. And here's what I tell Christians all the time. See, I didn't wear a big sign around my neck. Didn't wear a great big sign around my neck. I said, I love my daddy. It came pouring out of my life. People would come up to me and they say, well, you're just like your dad, don't you? Oh yeah, how do you know? And they would laugh. Some of them, they go, are you kidding? Everything you do and say says so. Here's what I understand today as a Christian. That attitude of heart, the heart that drove me, compelled me to be so much like my earthly father, the heart that I have, that I must have for my Savior. Because if that's not my heart, if he's not the most important thing in my life, then I'm not a Christian. Here's the thing, folks. You go to church your whole life and go right to hell. Just because you sleep in a car, sleep in a garage doesn't make you a car. Just because you go to church doesn't make you a Christian. Amen. It's about this, the attitude of your heart. Amen. And quite frankly, of course, I never know who's in the crowd. If you're here tonight, I don't care what church you go to. I don't care if you're Baptist, Methodist, Presbyterian, Lutheran, Pentecostal, Catholic, don't care. None of those things are going to get you to heaven. I don't know that. Well, Romans 10:9 says this: confess with your mouth Jesus is Lord. Believe in your heart that God raised him from the dead. You're saved.
Amen.
You're not saved because you got baptized. You're not saved because you got dunked or sprinkled. You're not saved because, you know, you speak in tongues. You're saved because you have a heart for God and you have a relationship with Jesus Christ. So let's quit spending all this time bickering about the things that we don't agree on. Come together on the things we must agree on. See some people in this world get saved. See, the devil uses all that division, all that denominationalism to separate us. I would even venture to guess that Pastor George, you know, he went around, spoke to a few churches, said we're going to do this and that. Yeah, I've been there before. Ah, that's great. No. They didn't bring anybody. They didn't come. Well, it's not their idea. They're not going to get credit for it. True story. There's a guy up in Canada, in Newfoundland, the easternmost part of Canada, that is trying to work on bringing me up there for a whole month, 30 days, 30 churches, or 20 churches. And he said, Ted, I can get the whole thing sponsored, the airfare, the hotels, the food, everything, and your honorariums, your fees. The churches aren't going to have to spend a dime. Here's what he ran into. He called me and said, Tim, this is unbelievable. He said, I'm calling these churches and I'm telling them that I can bring you up here. It's not going to cost them anything. And unless they can have you on a Friday, a Saturday, or Sunday, they don't want it. Well, that's the flesh. That's the flesh talking. Well, you know, if we do it on a weeknight, we might only have 10 or 15 people show up. I don't care. What if just one shows up and gets saved? What's one soul worth? Especially when it's not costing you anything. My friends, I share that with you because that is where the church is in North America today. By and large, not totally, but by and large, we're raising up missionaries. And we're sending them to third world countries. And they're raising up their own missionaries. Guess where they're sending them? Back here. Because they see the shallowness of our faith. We have faith in technology. We have faith in these. We have faith in all those things that comfort us. You know, when we hear about miracles, and I've witnessed a miracle. I was in India 3 times. Third time I was there, last stop, an orphanage. I was with 70 Canadians. 5 little girls in that orphanage were born deaf. They were deaf, they couldn't hear, they couldn't speak. And we laid hands on them, we prayed for them, and I watched God heal all 5 of them.
Amen. Hallelujah.
Why does that happen, people say? And I hear those stories about things like that happening in all these other countries. But I don't hear much of that happening here. It's still what happens here too. But I would venture to say that it doesn't happen here much because we don't have our faith in God. We don't have a childlike faith. We have our faith in technology. See, I come today to call the lost. Those of you who don't know Jesus at all. But I've also come as a brother in Christ and said, wake up. Wake up. If God doesn't judge the United States of America, he'd have to apologize to Sodom and Gomorrah. Murdering thousands and thousands of unborn children in the name of a woman's right to choose. Yeah, lady, you had a choice. And when you chose to get in bed, you take responsibility for the choice you made, and so does the guy you jumped in bed with. That's where you have a choice. You have to take responsibility for the choices you make. I speak to a lot of young people. There be some young people here. You know, I'll tell you the same thing I told my kids. I said, you know, we can't choose the circumstances of our life. We can't choose to be born black or white. We can't choose to be born into affluence or into poverty or somewhere in the middle. And we can't choose our parents. We can't choose to have loving parents or parents who abuse us in any one or a number of ways. But here's where we have a choice. We have to choose what we're going to do with the circumstances. You see, because if it's a bad circumstance, we can choose to use that circumstance as a crutch and your reason for being a failure all your life. That's what all addicts do. Or you can do whatever you have to do to climb out of that hole. And there's only one way to do that. His name is Jesus.
Amen.
I know. Been there. Done that. Everything in my life was going along pretty good until I was 15. When I was 15 years old, my dad suffered a heart attack in the ring in Lubbock, Texas, July the 2nd, 1969. And my whole world changed. Next thing you know, I'm in a little town in southern Arizona, Wilcox. Wilcox, Arizona has three traffic lights. It still has three traffic lights. Interstate 10 goes around Wilcox. You don't even have to go through Wilcox. I'm ending up in this little town with these great big dreams of college professional football. And all my peers in this little town, they hear that I want to do all these things and go to play college football, all that stuff. They thought I was a nut. You know, Ted, look around, it's Wilcox, it's going to happen here. Pal, relax, man, here, have a beer, smoke a joint, be cool, dude. Nope, didn't do that. If that weren't enough, the peer pressure, I watch in horror as my mother sinks into full-blown alcoholism virtually overnight. I go home and hear my mother say things like, I wish I would die. I just wish I would have nothing to live for anymore. Thanks a lot, Mom. How about me, my little brother? Now, if there was somebody that had the opportunity to get on a committee party, yep. Why didn't I? Two very good reasons. I had the influence of a very positive father figure in my life. And right now in the United States, 30% of our children are fatherless. When Hitler came to power in Germany after World War I, in Germany it was only 17%. And most of those kids didn't have dads because they got killed in the First World War. Not because they were deadbeats. And I'm not just talking about guys that get women pregnant and just take off. I'm talking about guys that are married and they come home every day and they are not engaged in the lives of their kids. Because if you think your job is simply to put bread on the table, As a man, your first obligation is to be the priest in your home. Took me a long time to figure that out, though. But what I had at 15 is what I look back at and call a childlike faith. Somewhat misguided by Roman Catholicism. Now, again, I'm not up here bashing Catholicism. I have a lot of issues with the Catholic Church. And I'd be more than willing to discuss that with anybody in here that happens to be Catholic later. But the bottom line is this, Catholic or not, do I have a relationship with Jesus Christ? There were many nights I'd go out to the cemetery where my dad's buried, and I'd park my grandmother's old car, Rambler, shine the lights on his grave, and I'd pace back and forth in front of that grave, and I'd cry. I'd pray, God, give me the strength and the talent. Give me the tools I need to accomplish the goals I've had. Let me show my mom I should quit giving up on life. Let me show my friends that getting drunk, getting high, and being cool isn't what life is about. But I was praying in a very childlike way as, Lord, if you'll give me the desires of my heart, I will honor you with it. Was I a perfect child? Absolutely not. I had a lot of, just like anybody else. But by and large, I made the right decisions. And God's faithful. And as it turned out, I was the first kid to graduate from this little town in southern Arizona with a full scholarship to play Division I college football. I ended up going to West Texas State up in the Panhandle of Texas. It's West Texas A&M now. But when I got to college, two things crept into my life, took over in my life, and then consumed me for the next 20 years. My male pride and my ego. Your ego, E-G-O, will always edge God out. The Bible says pride goeth before the fall. Amen. Amen. He said, I wasn't scared anymore. I had accomplished all these things, and now I got my chest all bowed out. And boy, look what I did. I did all this thing. I worked hard, man. I got that scholarship. And nobody's talking trash about me now, are they? I can almost see Jesus reaching out, tapping me on the shoulder, going, hey, wait a minute, what about all the nights in the cemetery when you cried out to me? Have you forgotten so soon? Yep. And that's human nature. You know, 9/11, when 9/11 happened, the churches filled all over America for about a month. And each week went by and nothing else happened, well, we just kind of put God back on the shelf and said, you know, Lord, stay up there. When I need you again, I'll let you know. But that's basically what I did. Not in word, but by actions. You know, we live in a culture today where most men evaluate their masculinity by stupid things like how much beer they can drink, and how big their biceps are, what kind of car they drive, what music they listen to, what kind of clothes they wear, and all that stuff. And unfortunately, on that list, how many women they can bet. Any of you guys in the room that think that's being a man, I got two words for you. Grow up. You're not a man. As a matter of fact, you're a wimp. Been there, done that too. The measure of a man is the strength of his character, the size of his integrity. A real man is a man of his word. His word's his bond. He's only as good as his word. And if his word's no good, he's worthless. That's why we need to throw everybody out of Washington and start over. How can you tell a politician's lying? His lips are moving. By the time I was 26, I had failed to complete college by 1 year. I didn't go to the NFL. I was married and divorced. I failed as a father. I now have a young son, my firstborn son, Michael, who, because of that divorce, I couldn't be with, except on weekends and special occasions. But now I'm a professional wrestler. And folks, what I believe God said to Ted was, go ahead, son, go get all those things you think you want. I'm going to let you have them. You go climb that ladder of material success. Go become that big famous wrestler you want to be. Go get all that stuff and find out what it's like there in your life without me. somewhere down the road, you and I are going to have another discussion about this. You know, I ask you like the parents, you know, it's like, how many parents, you know? How many parents are there who got teenagers? You know, isn't it funny how when our kids become teenagers, all of a sudden they think we're stupid? You know, your mom, dad, you know, we're not hip, we're not cool. You have a smartphone, it's smarter than us. Yep. You don't know what Twitter is? Are you kidding? And they think because we give them boundaries and we give them all these rules they have to follow, we're just a bunch of killjoys. We just don't want them to have any fun. So I just want to grab them and shake them and go, look, you little moron. I've only got 20 years of life experience on you. I've already been down the road. I know what's coming. I've been there myself. I know what you're thinking, and I know what's going on. And the boundaries and the rules are to protect you because I love you. Let's take that up one notch. Our Heavenly Father, 20 years of life experience, right? Our Heavenly Father says, I'm only the God of the universe, and I've only been around forever. I've given you a standard to live by. Not because I want to be a killjoy, but that you would have life and have it more abundantly. The words of Jesus. That if we would just follow the rules, we'd be happier. We've all been teenagers. Some of them don't grow up. Unfortunately, some of them never grow up. Some of them take a very long time. Took this one 38 years. So I start climbing the ladder of success, becoming a very well-known professional wrestler in the inner circles of our industry. Along the way in Atlanta, Georgia, on April the 26th, to be exact, 1981, met a young lady, Melanie Kennedy, a Christian girl, walks into my life. And I fall madly in love. I don't want to have any more children that I can't see except on weekends and special occasions. I want to do things right. No more divorces. It's funny how God starts coming back into the equation here. So I begin to attend church with my wife, Melanie. We were married on New Year's Eve, 1981. It's the first time I heard the gospel preached out of the Bible and not the what they call the catechism. It's the first time in my life that I heard that my eternity hinged on a personal relationship with Jesus. It's the first time I walked the aisle, said that prayer we call the sinner's prayer. I had a very emotional experience that day. I wept some tears. I walked out of there feeling pretty good. But here's the point, my friends. I didn't surrender. Oh, yes. Oh, yes, Lord Jesus. I believe you are who you say. I believe the gospel. I believe that Jesus is the Son of God, that he was born of the Virgin Mary, that he suffered and died at the hands of Pontius Pilate, crucified, horrible death. I believe that he rose from the dead, that he sits at the right hand of God the Father, that he's coming again in glory to judge the world, to take on those who put their faith in him. But here's the difference between heaven and hell. 18 inches, moving it from here to here. I just finished a great book. It's been out a while. I just turned around to read it. It's called The Fan. Get it. If you're a Christian, get it and read it. It will convict you. Are you a fan of Jesus Christ or are you a follower? You see, fans know all about the teams they support. They wear their colors. They can give you all the statistics. But do they really know any of those people on that team? Do they know them intimately? Have they suffered on with them out there on the field? Have they been down in the trenches with them? No, they're a fan. Go, man, go.
Jesus said, take up your cross and follow me. He didn't say it was going to be a cakewalk either. As a matter of fact, he said, the world hated me. And guess what? If the world hated me, the world's going to hate you. Take great joy, I've overcome the world. We know how the story ends. If we really believe it. If we really believe it. That's the key. Well, I didn't run out of that church that morning and run by a Bible and dive into the scripture and dive into the relationship. You know, I was wrestling virtually every day and sometimes twice on Sunday. Looking back, reality is the God in my life was my career. Basically what I was saying to God, not by word but by action, was, Lord, I want everything you have offered. I believe Jesus is the only way. I want him to be Lord. Well, maybe I just want him to be Savior. I never said that, but that's what my action said. Basically, my action said, I want what you have to offer on my terms, not yours. If I can go be a big star in wrestling and have all this stuff, then we're cool. I didn't say that. That's exactly what my action said, though. What did Jesus, again, the words of Jesus, you'll recognize the tree by the fruit. He said a good tree can't bear bad fruit, and a bad tree can't bear good fruit. And every tree that doesn't bear good fruit is cut down and thrown in the fire. There is an epidemic of casual Christianity in America. There's a lot of people going to church every Sunday, and they're well on their way to hell, and they don't even know it. Because they think because they show up and put in their hour, and that's right, they'll sit there by golly, pastor, you better not go a minute over your time. I need to be at that steakhouse before that other church is. Golly, pastor, great sermon, but man, if you don't let us out of here in the next 10 minutes, that church, you know what? I won't be back in front of my big screen for kickoff. Where's your heart, pal?
Yeah.
Last time I checked, Sunday was the Lord's day, not his hour. And oh yeah, how much do you tithe? Ooh, here we go. Only 6% of the people that are claim Christianity, 6% of them faithfully tithe. You know what the tithe is? 10% of time, talent, treasures. 10% of everything. That's what we owe God. That's not even an offering. That's what we owe God. And if we were just giving what we owe him, he said he'd open the windows of heaven and pour out so much blessing we couldn't get it all. But we have to have faith to do that.
Mm-hmm.
We have to demonstrate faith to do that.
Yep.
And the Bible also says without faith it is impossible to please God. So, are you a Christian? Or are you just a fan? That's my question. That's my question everywhere I go today in the world we live in as I watch it start disintegrating around me. And I won't go political. I'll be up another hour if I do. But what about me? What happened to me? God blessed me with this incredible, wonderful Christian life. God blessed us with two more children, our sons Ted and Brett. God gave me back the son from my first marriage, Michael, who came to live with us when he was 11. I couldn't have been more blessed, and the truth is I couldn't have been less grateful. And then in 1987, I got the biggest break of my wrestling career. I get the call from Vince McMahon. Next thing you know, I'm sitting in his office in Stamford, Connecticut, the top of the, what they call Titan Tower. And Vince says, I got a plan, man. So I think you're the guy for this, you know. Always good guys and bad guys in wrestling. And he says, you know, the one thing everybody hates. Everybody hates a guy who, by virtue of his wealth, thinks he's better than everybody. Looks down his nose at people, thinks he can buy anything and anybody. I started chuckling. I said, I can't stand guys like that myself. And he said, that is, in essence, this character we want you to be. We think you can do this. You're very articulate. You carry yourself well. And he says, in an effort to market this character, we're going to try to make the public believe you're really rich. I said, really? How are you going to do that? Well, we're going to send you everywhere first class. First class airfare, sometimes that's private jets. You'll have limousine service every day in every city, and you'll stay at the Hilton, the Hyatt, the Marriott, no more Red Roof Inn. It's a tough job. Somebody had to do it, right?
Yeah. Cool.
Wow. Just prior to that meeting, I had walked the aisle a second time. I had stood at another platform and said the sinner's prayer and gotten baptized again. And very lovingly warned that the devil would come quickly to pluck the seed that God had planted in my life before it had had time to take root. And the pastor said, Ted, he'll attack you. He will attack you where the weakest and the most vulnerable. And looking back, I didn't see it. But that's exactly what he did. Where did he attack me? My pride. My ego. I got just what I thought I wanted. Did I drop to my knees and thank God for it? Oh, I gave God a little lip service, yeah. But then I say, you know what, Lord, with this new opportunity, I'm going to be the Tim Tebow of the WWF. Could have done that. You see, there was no real relationship. And if the only time you crack this book is on Sunday morning, I'm sorry, you have a very shallow, if any, relationship with Jesus. Because he's got to talk to you. And he speaks to us through the word, through the circumstances of our life, and through the people who he'll cross our paths with. And we speak to him through our prayer life. And it's not our wish list. Oh, God, help me this. Help me with that. Help me with this. Help me with that. Yes, we're supposed to bring our needs to God. But we bring our worship first. And we should have a reverent fear of the Lord. For who he is and how awesome he is. Well, like the dad, lets the kid go, God will let me go. So here I am, now I'm the $1 million man, Learjets and limousines. And as my old buddy Ric Flair says, what's he say? Limousine riding, I can't even remember it.
Woo!
Oh, yeah, there you go, that's Rick. Traveling the world. Likeness made into action figures, put on video games. You can still get my action figure, by the way. It's the classic series. It's right up so old on the classic. But because there was this void in my life, this emptiness, it was an emptiness that had to be filled. And because I wasn't in the Word of God, because there was no real relationship with God, because I was just the ritual Christian, not even a good job of going through the ritual. The void had to be filled. There's this God-sized hole we all have. We're born with it. We got to fill that void, and we'll fill it with all the junk in the world, and the devil knows just what buttons to push. And we always think about the hardcore things, drugs, and alcohol, and you know. But there are all kinds of idols in life. I live in Mississippi now for 30 years. There's men in my community that worship at an altar called Deer Season. Oh my gosh. The money they spent on all-terrain vehicles and camo and all that stuff, and they join these clubs, and man, but I mean, hundreds and thousands of dollars. I mean, they map out their whole, I mean, they plan their life around deer season. Man, when that offering plate goes by on Sunday morning, all of a sudden they got deep pockets and short arms. God gets the leftovers. You know what I say to you? Keep it. God doesn't want your leftovers. He wants your first and your best, and that's what he deserves. So I had to fill the void. And so like so many others in my industry, the void was filled by drugs and alcohol and other women. Just like the song says. Now by the grace of God, I was never addicted to drugs or to booze. I guess if you could call it an addiction, it would be the women. And yeah, that is an addiction too. God will give you enough rope to hang yourself, and his timing is perfect. March 1992, WrestleMania 8 took place in Indianapolis, Indiana. I was at the height of my career. Wrestled that night, the big show, and then with the old Hoosier Dome, it's not even there anymore. New building there. Went out that night on town, tailor-made suit, gold Rolex watch, big gold chain around my neck, beautiful girl on each arm. I am cool. I am so stupid. I go to all the hot spots in Indianapolis where I'm sure to be seen. While my wife is at home taking care of our children, holding down the fort, paying the bills, and trusting me, I didn't even go to bed that night. I had that limousine take me to the airport about 6 o'clock in the morning. Flew to Detroit, checked into the Marriott Hotel, walked to a payphone in the lobby to call home and check in. What a nice guy. What a jerk. Big surprise that day on the other end of the phone. This time, a very angry, distraught wife. A wife who had trusted me unconditionally. A wife who had bore 2 children for me, a wife who had accepted my son from a previous marriage as her own son, loved him and raised him as her own. A wife who never called me anywhere in the world because she trusted me. That wife had now discovered that I was committing adultery on a massive scale. I don't want to talk about this on the phone. I'll be the next plane home. She said, no, you won't. You don't live here anymore. Click. Ooh. First words out of my mouth, don't you know? God help me. Oh, God help me. What a hypocrite. Hypocrisy. Oh, my gosh. Oh, yes, God. You're the God that I cried out to when I was 15, when my dad died and my mom started drinking. And you know what, Lord? You came to me there. You brought me comfort there. I got the scholarship. I went to college and I abandoned you. And in spite of that, you brought this wonderful Christian woman into my life, Melanie. You blessed me and her with 2 more children. You gave me back my son. Then you blessed my career beyond my wildest hope or expectation. And I did it again. So what did I deserve from God? I deserved what the Bible says we all deserve, hell. And make no mistake, my friends, if there is a heaven, there is a hell. Not enough preachers preaching hell anymore. Nobody talked more about it in all of the Bible than Jesus himself. He spoke more about it than anybody. What did he say? He said, enter through the narrow gate. For wide is the gate and broad is the path that leads to death, meaning hell. And many there enter through. But small is the gate and narrow the path that leads to life, meaning heaven. And only a few find it. I don't know what that tells you, but it tells me that hell will outpopulate heaven. Right. Except by God's mercy and grace. Another scripture. Jesus said, if your eye causes you sin, gouge it out. If your arm causes you sin, cut it off. Better go through life blind and crippled than to burn in hell. That's pretty graphic. If you don't know Jesus as you sit here, I want you to understand how serious this is. When Adam committed that sin, when Adam and Eve sinned in the garden and destroyed our relationship with God, God had no choice. God cannot look on sin. He just cannot. There's no way. He can't even look at it. And when Jesus hung on the cross and became sin for our sake, the only time in all of eternity that God ever turned his face away from his son. So we had to have somebody bail us out, because if we didn't have a bailout, there was no hope. Because it is impossible for us to live a sinless life. We're born in this flesh, and from the day we're born in it until the day it takes its last breath, it's wretched, it stinks, it seeks to serve itself. You know, oftentimes we say, well, the devil made me do it. No, no, we don't need the devil's help. We can be just as selfish as we can be on our own. But here's when we get the devil's attention. When you figure it out. When you finally get to a place where you've hit the wall enough times where you figure out, I can't do this by myself. I keep coming back to this dead end, and I don't want to be here anymore. Jesus, help me. Now you've got the devil's attention. Now he'll come quickly to pluck this seed. Which is exactly what he did to me. No, I'm not going to let this happen. Let's give him everything he thinks he wants. The next call I made that day was to a man who's my dearest friend today. His name is Pastor Al Santos. I met Al at a gym in Baton Rouge in 1982. Right after Melanie and I were married, big guy walked up to me in the gym and says, seen you on television, Ted. I'm a local youth minister at the time. He said, I just got to ask you one question. I said, sure. Do you know Jesus? So let's sit down and talk about that. That started a relationship. This guy prayed for me for the next 12 years. He never beat me up with religion. For 12 years, as I look back, I realize that what this man did was demonstrate to me the unconditional love of Jesus Christ. He was my friend. And in my darkest hour, I didn't call my pastor at home. Nice guy. 5 minutes away, I called a man 500 miles away. What was the difference? One word, relationship. Without that relationship, there's nothing. And without a relationship with Jesus, there's nothing. I flew to St. Louis. He picked me up at the airport, took me on the longest 30-minute ride of my life to go face my wife who had arrived ahead of me. And he said this to me. He said, Ted, Jesus said the truth would set you free. He never said it'd be easy. He never said it'd be painless. He said he'd set you free. He said, if you'll trust Jesus, if you'll trust him today, the way you did when you were 15 and you cried out to him in that desert cemetery, he'll forgive you. He'll restore you. He said, but I have to also tell you, there's no guarantee that this is going to save your marriage. Because the Bible also says, you reap what you sow. There are always consequences to the choices we make in life. And then he said something I had never heard put that way before. He said, Ted, he said, understand that Jesus being both fully God and fully man, he's the God who put every star in the sky that you see. He's the God who knew when you would take your first breath and when you would take your last and everything you would do in between. And he's the God who, if he were the only man who ever lived, would have still stepped out of heaven and died on that cross just for you. And when I looked into the sky that night, and on one of those nights where you could see all the stars, and try to imagine a God that big who could love me that much. I was overwhelmed. And I looked at my life. Oh yeah. By the world standard, huge success. Top of my game. Their jets, limousines, making great money. All the stuff people think will make them happy. All you have to do is go pick up a tabloid magazine when you leave here. Tabloids make millions of dollars off of the misery of people. Because all the tabloid magazines are about rich and famous people, movie stars, rock stars, professional athletes, the rich and the famous who we all think we want to be. But all those stories are about drug addiction, alcoholism, suicide, and infidelity. I guess they're really not so happy, are they? I had to look in the mirror that day and see a man who, in spite of God's blessing in his life, had been willing to put at risk the love and devotion of a community.
committed wife and put at risk the future, the stability, the peace of mind, and the well-being of his own children. All for what? To stroke his ego. I wasn't unhappy at home. I was on this massive ego trip. It doesn't get better than that. But to think that God could love me that much, in spite of those times, almost every time he blessed me, I trampled on it. Is our God a God of second chances? Yes, and third chances, and fourth chances. God never gives up on us. He never leaves us. He never quits pursuing us. Can we get to a place where he will stop? Yeah. We can. But is there still hope even then? Yep. But we would have to come back. It's never hopeless unless you just turn away from it. My friends, that's the day I fell in love with my Savior. That's the day when I said, here's my life, Lord. You take it. You know what? My first marriage ended. A lot of the same reasons. Here I am, just like the proverb says, as a dog returns to his mama, so the fool returns to his folly. Well, there I am. I've come back. Here I am again. I don't ever want to feel this way again. I don't ever want to look in the mirror and see this guy anymore. Come on board the ship of Ted's life and take the helm, Lord. You take the ship wherever you want it to go. You see, here's what I want you to understand, my friends. Before you can ever commit to Jesus Christ, the first thing you have to do is surrender. And you surrender everything, because it's his anyway. God has a plan for your life. But you're never going to know what God's plan for your life is as long as you keep trying to shove your plan down his throat. I guarantee this, whatever God has for you is far greater and more and richer in every way than you could ever dream. When we got to Pastor Howe's house, I took the longest walk of my life to the door to face my wife, and I said that prayer again. But it was different this time. This time, I had surrendered. And I even said, Lord, I'm not here to make a deal with you. I'm not here saying, save my marriage, save my family. I don't deserve that. I deserve to lose that. Just let me be man enough to face this like a man and tell the truth. It's the hardest, most gut-wrenching thing I've ever done. I watched my wife walk out of the room that day and tears and look back at me and go, who are you, Ted? Where's the man I thought I married? Let me tell you how Jesus said that. It's basically what my wife was saying. You know what? When you stood before God and witnesses and you made a commitment, you took a vow to love and honor and cherish me and no one else. And what I see standing here and what I agreed to that day, well, they're not the same. So who are you? Now here's how Jesus said it. Matthew 7:21 was literally scared hell out of me the first time I read it and understood it. Jesus said these words, just because you say to me, Lord, Lord, doesn't mean you will enter the kingdom of heaven. But only he who does the will of my Father in heaven. Many will come in that day and say, Lord, did we not prophesy in your name? In your name we drove out demons. We did miracles. And then I will tell them plainly, I never knew you. Depart from me, you who practice it. Who's he talking to? He's not talking to murderers, rapists, and drug dealers. He's talking to people who go to church every week, take up pew space, and do nothing. It's all about the heart. 2 days later, I agreed to go with my pastor friend to this big youth rally in Chicago. I walked into this big ballroom, 1,500 teenagers, and I had highlighted blonde hair. I looked like that guy. stuck out like a sore thumb. There's Tim DiBiase, the $1 million man. What's he doing here? What was I doing there? I confessed to God, my wife, and Pastor Hal. Nobody else to confess to. No coincidences with God, just like there is no coincidence. Why was I there? As I look back, I understand it. I was a man with a pride problem. I was a man who had an ego problem. So God put me in front of 1,500 wrestling fans, teenagers. When the invitation was given, God wanted to know one thing. Will you get out of your chair? Will you go forward in humility in front of all these people who see you as a star from television? You betcha. As a matter of fact, I beat every kid in that building to the front of the room, fell on my face and cried like a baby. Here's what I want you to understand. That's what God wants all of us at some point in time in our life, willing to run to Him with reckless abandon. In a place where you don't care what anybody thinks anymore. Or you don't care how it looks. When you finally get to a place where you understand there's only one person that you have to answer to or be worried about, and that's Him. Yes. And I finally got to that place. And I laid there crying and weeping. These kids came up, and I'll never forget it. They came up and they pulled me off my face. They were crying. I was hugging them. They were hugging me. All the same in the eyes of God. Then my wife, who witnessed all this, came to me. And Melanie said this to me. She said, Ted, I'm not going to make you a promise I can't keep. I don't know if I'm strong enough to do this. She goes, I've heard what you have to say. And I've seen all of this. And she goes, you know what? I think you want to be a man of God. I'm just not sure you're a man of God. I'm not sure you can do it. But I serve God in restoration, not divorce. Because I love Jesus, and because I want to be obedient to this voice in my heart, I'm going to try. Friends, I want to tell you something. Nobody in my entire life has ever demonstrated to me more the love and compassion of Christ than my wife did in that moment. Any other woman would have run. Any other woman would have. There's just no way. But because she was so grounded in her relationship with God, she listened to that voice. And she was very honest. She goes, I might not make it. I had just read Dr. Ed Cole's first book, Maximize Manhood, about being a real man. And I looked at my wife and I said, if you'll give me this chance, I'll become the man you thought you married. I'll become a spiritual leader in my home. I will become a man of character and integrity. And God willing, one day I'll regain your trust and respect. That was March 1992. Just before we came here tonight, I got on my iPhone and I called home. And I talked to my grandson, Tate. My son, Teddy's firstborn son, and my wife, Melanie. This next New Year's Eve, we'll celebrate our 33rd wedding anniversary. And folks, you know what? God knew just fix it. God did just exactly what He said He would do. He said, I come that you have life and have it out more abundantly. My relationship with my wife today is far greater, far richer. She is my soulmate, my very best friend. Yes, we went through hell together. It wasn't overnight. It was 2 years. 2 years of fire. 2 years of a man trying to prove himself. 2 years of a woman trying to forget. But as my wife began to see my life bear fruit, as she began to come in and see me sitting at the table with a cup of coffee and the Bible open at 6 o'clock in the morning, one devotional after another, and as she watched me begin to lead my family in prayer and lead them to church, as she began to see my life bear fruit, all those things came back. And I've heard my wife say it. She goes, you know, when you hang on to anger and bitterness, she goes, when Ted confessed to me, threw himself at the mercy of the court, ball's in my court now, there's only one or two choices. I either forgive him or I don't. And she goes, I can forgive him and leave. Could have. And I knew I biblically had the right to do that. But when you hang on to anger and bitterness, the only one suffering from it is you. It's like drinking poison and expecting somebody else to die. Forgiveness isn't optional with God, it's a command. I still would be here speaking to you tonight. But the only reason I can stand here and say I'm still a happily married man is not because of the decisions I have made. Oh yes, I had to make those decisions. I had to begin to walk in a genuine faith. But the reason I can stand here and say I'm still happily married is because of my wife stepping up. So my question right now is this, as you sit here tonight, is Jesus Lord in your life? There's a difference between him being your Savior and being Lord. Is he Lord in your life? Is he the most important thing in your life? Or have you, and it's easy for us. I mean, I know there's times when, even in ministry, I get all caught up in the work I have to do. And it starts chipping away at my personal time with him. And he's got to come along and say, hey, remember me? Remember why you're doing this? Because the devil is a liar and he's so subtle. Is he Lord in your life? Is he number one? Is he your all and all tonight? And I don't know, maybe there's someone here tonight that just came to see the wrestler. But you've heard enough of the gospel tonight to save you or send you to hell. And no matter where you are, what you've done, no matter how bad you think you are or how bad you may be, there's a guy that says to you right now, I stand at the door. If you'll open the door, I'll come in and I'll change your life. I'll take you just the way you are. You can't, don't think you can go out and clean yourself up. And because a lot of people think, oh, I'm going to go clean myself up where God will listen to me. God will take you right now, just the way you are. He'll clean you up.
Yeah, that's right.
If you let him.
Right.
If you let him. Are you, do you need to recommit yourself to the purpose of that relationship? Maybe you've let the busyness of your life choke you out. Maybe. You know, gosh, you know, those things, those words of Jesus, I wish that you were hot or cold because you're lukewarm. I'm about to spit you out of my mouth. And to the one church, he said, Revelation, he said, you've done many things well, but go back and do the things you did at the beginning. What would Jesus say to you now? If he were to let himself be seen, because he's here. He said, wherever two or more gather in my name, I am in the place. He is here. So if he were to manifest himself and look you in the eye, what would he see? What would he say? And what would you say? With that thought, I'd ask you all to bow your heads and close your eyes. I'm going to pray a prayer. And I just pray that as I pray this prayer, you just speak to the Lord from your heart. Not my words, but your words. God wants to hear from you. But more important than what you say to him, listen to his voice in your heart tonight. And most importantly, be obedient to what he says. Lord Jesus, I come to you now and I confess to you that I'm a sinner. I realize, Lord, that in and of myself, and of my own power and strength, the truth is, Lord, I'm helpless. God, I'm tired of failing. I'm tired of starting over. I'm tired of looking into the mirror and seeing that reflection. Lord, I don't want to see that anymore. I don't ever want to come back to this place. I don't ever want to feel like this again. Tonight, I realize, perhaps for the very first time, that all I need in my life can be found in one place. And that one place is in you, Lord. Tonight, Lord, I ask you from the bottom of my heart as I confess my sin, forgive me. Come into my life tonight, Lord. Not just as Savior, but Lord of all. Tonight, Lord, I recommit myself to the purpose of that relationship. Forgive me, Lord, for straying. Forgive me for allowing the busyness of my life and all the things around me to choke it out. Tonight, Lord, renew in me a steadfast spirit. Tonight, Lord, I ask not only forgiveness, but Lord, that you deliver me from the bondage of the drug addiction, the bondage of pornography, the bondage of alcoholism, the bondage of anything that is in my life that I'm in bondage to, that keeps me out of fellowship with you. Tonight, Lord, deliver me from the bondage of anger and bitterness, Lord. I've held this grudge for so long. And tonight I understand the only one it's killing is me. Set me free that I might have fellowship with you as you would have with me. And Jesus, thank you. Thank you for your presence here tonight. Thank you, Lord, for hearing every cry, prayer, and plea. Thank you, Lord, for your promised forgiveness and restoration. But Jesus, thank you most of all for loving us all enough to step down out of heaven and die for us on the cross. Thank you, Lord. We pray this prayer in your precious and matchless name, the name that is above every name, the name Jesus. Amen. And amen. Now I'm going to ask you, if you would, eyes closed, heads bowed, nobody looking around. There's not a lot of folks here, but I can see you. This is just between you and me. Again, eyes closed, heads bowed. If you made a decision of some kind tonight, I just want to acknowledge you. This is just between you and me personally. So, with eyes closed and heads bowed, the first question I would ask is, if you prayed a prayer tonight with me, or that prayer that I just prayed, that for the very first time in your life, you've asked Jesus into your heart. If you're here tonight and you just made a first-time decision, would you raise your hand high enough so I can see it? Are there any first-time decisions here? God bless you. God bless you. Praise God. Praise God. Second question. If you're here tonight, maybe the Lord spoke to your heart. Tonight is a night that you need to rededicate yourself to that relationship. Like David said, restore me, Lord, an upright spirit. You've not been on this journey. You're a Christian. But every now and then, we gotta have the friend come along. And then I have that friend. I'm that Christian friend that came along and kind of kicked you in the seat of the pants and said, hey, wake up. Don't let the devil entice you and draw you away. But tonight's the night you need to rededicate yourself to the purpose of that relationship. If that's you, eyes closed, heads bowed, would you raise your hand for me so I can acknowledge that? God bless you. God bless you. God bless you. If tonight's the night you need to seek not just forgiveness, but deliverance from the bondage of a sin, a habitual repetitive sin, whether it's drug addiction, alcoholism, pornography, gambling, there's so many different things that draw us away. But it's one thing to ask for forgiveness, and God will forgive us, but the reason we have to keep coming back and asking Him again and again is because the Bible also says we're to confess our sins one to another. And until you let it out, until you find that person who you can say, yes, this is what I'm dealing with, you're going to be in bondage to it. So if you need deliverance from the bondage of a sin tonight, and that's your prayer, you're willing to say, yes, I'm going to leave here tonight dead, and I'm going to confess this, and I'm going to get to the root of it. If that's you tonight, eyes closed, heads bowed, you simply raise your hand so I can acknowledge that decision. God bless you. If you're here tonight and you're in the bondage of bitterness, anger, somebody's hurt you real bad. I can't tell you how many broken men that I've spoken to in prison that hold a grudge and they're bitter, they're angry at their dads. Their dads that they never knew, a dad that never gave them any affirmation, never loved them, never. You know, and I tell them, I say, you know what, you can't go through life hanging on to this grudge, blaming your dad for what he did or didn't do. You got to let it go. Because the only one that's destroying is you. So if tonight's a night where you need to say, Lord, I can't seem to do this with my strength, but I will believe tonight in your strength. You will set me free. If that's your prayer, would you raise your hand so I could acknowledge that decision? Are you dealing with anger and bitterness? Anybody? Okay. All right, folks. Look up here. Now it's time to get in the ring, so to speak. When I went to Chicago, 1,500 teenagers, the speaker that day was a black guy named Reggie Dabbs, and man, he could bring it. And I remember his words. He said, if you're tired of living a lie, you understand what you need, and you're unashamed of the gospel, you really meant what you said, what you prayed, if you raised your hand and you meant it, he said, then get out of your chair and get up here now. That's when the million-dollar man leaped out of his chair and beat every kid in that room in the front and fell on his face. I didn't care anymore. It changed my life forever. So if you raise your hand tonight, I want you to step out of your chair and I want you to come stand right here, right now, because we're going to pray for you again. If you raise your hand for any reason, I want you to come.
We thank you, Lord, for the
The victories that we see kneeling here today were won 2,000 years ago at the cross. And the praise and the glory and the honor, Lord, they are yours and yours alone. And we give that to you now. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Jesus. And finally, Lord, we pray this, and as we pray everything, in your precious, matchless name, the name that is above every name under heaven and earth, in the name of Jesus, and all God's people said, amen and amen. Give the Lord a hand. Yeah, give the Lord a hand. That's awesome. That is awesome. I want to thank you, and I want to thank Pastor George for stepping out and inviting me to come. And I, you know, and again, I want to stress this. I know sometimes there can be, oh, you know what, I wish the place was full. Well, you know what, we all wish the place was full. But one soul is worth it. And if we believe that and we walk in that, you know, God will build on it. God will build on it. We just have to trust Him. And I want to thank all of you, and especially you, Pastor, for inviting me to come here. And I'll be with you tomorrow morning, and there's what you can do. I know all of you who are Christians, you got to have at least one friend. Somebody you know that needs Jesus. If nothing else, call them and ask them. They might say no, but call that friend and ask him tonight. So will you come to church with me tomorrow? Because there's a guy here whose story you need to hear. I want to challenge you to do that. You know, Pastor Tommy Barnett, he really convicted me one time. He said, think about this, Ted. He says, as you go back to the WWE, as it's now known, he said, I'm not telling you to wear, you know, great big giant cross around your neck and strap a Bible to your hip, but he says, don't be ashamed of the gospel. He said, and remember this, he said, God will open doors for you to minister to these guys. But think about this. Think, because out of fear, you never said anything to any of them. Or one of them dies and goes to hell and says this to you from hell, why didn't you tell me? I knew you 20 years. You had the greatest news in the world and you never bothered to tell me. Boy, did that convict me. So think about somebody in your life that you know and at least call them and invite them, and at least you'll know in your own heart that you reached out. Because 90% of all professing believers in America, in the United States, have never met a soul of Christ. So thank you so much for those who came. I mean, I know you're here because you love the Lord. And I thank you for coming. And I look forward to seeing you tomorrow morning, Pastor.
Thank you so much. For those of you who came forward in prayer tonight, you should have received a little card when you came in. If you didn't, we have some here. And all that, we're not trying to set you up on a database to sell you something, but you need some Christian friends, and we want to be your friend. The glad tidings is simply of God. We believe more than anything else that God is a God of second chances, and that God is a God of love, and we want to be there to help walk with you on this road, whether it's starting again or starting anew. We want to be there to help hold your hand and walk you through this. So if you would fill out that card, you're not obligated to, but if you will, and give it to one of our workers, we are going to call you or send you a letter or something to let you know what the services are at the church. Somebody's going to call you and tell you how much they love you and that we're praying for you, because we are. And we'll look forward to joining with you in this journey, in this relationship with Jesus Christ. Service tomorrow morning at 11 o'clock, and there will be no evening service because it's Father's Day. So we look forward to seeing you there. God bless you.